BBC Audio presents Ballet Shoes and More, three full-cast dramatisations of the very best classic children's tales, written by Noel Streatfeild.
Ballet Shoes by Noel Streatfeild, dramatised by Ellen Dryden.
It stopped raining, Pauline.
Completely.
Enough to make sure that we have to
save the penny and walk. Yes, that's definitely walking weather. I do like living on the Cromwell Road, of course. But Great Uncle Matthew must have been a very taxi person. He couldn't ever have thought about walking, or he'd never have bought a house at the end of the longest road in London.
I expect he had a motor car all his own, and he never hired anything.
I wonder if he'll ever come back home.
Oh, of course he will. Gum's much too important not to.
I don't know why you're so sure, Petrova. I can't remember him, so I'm certain you can't. And Posy was a tiny baby when he went away.
This has been his longest fossil hunting expedition yet. That's why he'll surprise us. He'll bring something extraordinary back with him.
Yes, I suppose so. He's been like the stork in the fairy tale, hasn't he? He practically did bring us back in his beak, nearly 15 years ago.
Fossils, 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 and how am I supposed to look after this house when every room from the basement to the attic is full to bursting with the nasty things? Now, Miss Sylvia, dear, you must tell your great-uncle Matthew not another fossil until a few have gone out of the door.
Oh, Nana, you know how he hates to part with any of them. We'll have a terrible upset. He only bought this huge house for his precious finds.
It's all very well giving us a home and poor little orphan scrap that you were, but I didn't bring you up to be a museum attendant. Just here to keep an eye on these fossils. And some of them will have to go.
Very well, Nana. I'll do as you say, but he won't be happy about it.
He'll see sense in the end, you mark my words.
Sense? What do you mean, sense? It's nonsense.
But come, dear, there's no...
Not
for...
a fossil leaves this house except over my dead body!
Nana, look. There's a notice in the Times. Professor Matthew Brown has given another generous gift of fossils to the Natural History Museum.
Good, about time.
Well, don't you think it's rather sad? They'll be taking away some very important specimens. That means some of the largest.
Oh, we'll see a bit of daylight then, and I shall be able to get round the rooms and clean them properly at last.
Here you are, Sylvia, my dear. This is what I plan to do. I shall make my way along this river valley here, and then I shall strike up into the mountains on the globe here. Do you see? And that's where I hope to find some more fossils to make up for the ones that have gone. I'm really very hopeful about this expedition.
Yes, Gum, dear, of course you are.
There's a letter just arrived for you, Miss Sylvia. It's from the professor, by the look of things. Are we to expect another great crate of fossils?
Oh, no. Oh, Nana.
What?
The most dreadful news. Gum has had a terrible accident.
Climbing
a mountain. After a specimen. He crushed his leg so badly that he had to have it taken off. Oh, poor dear Gum. He lives for his fossils. What will he do now he can't go hunting for them anymore?
I've travelled a lot on land, my dear, but very little by sea. Now I shall really see the world, just like Long John Silver with a wooden leg, eh? And maybe I'll find something interesting to bring back.
Oh, well... There's
no need to do that, sir. The house is full enough as it is. We don't want a lot of carved elephants and that about the place.
Carved elephants? The world is full of entrancements, woman. Any of which I might bring home. And you talk to me of carved elephants.
But I'm sure I'm pleased you should see these entrancements, as you call them, sir. You let them bide. We want nothing more in this house.
Halter, sir?
No, thank you, my good man. This is all the luggage I have. I can manage.
Well, I never. Here, George, do you see what old Dot and Caddywan's got tucked underneath his arm?
Sylvia! Sylvia! God gracious me, I keep a pack of women in the house and none of them are about when they're wanted.
Any more sheets to mend and mark, Nana?
No, that's a lot.
Sylvia!
Ah! Isn't that the professor's voice? God.
Oh, darling, come! Why didn't you let me know you were coming?
Oh, why should I waste a stamp? Look, I brought you a present.
A baby.
A baby?
Yes, a baby. Thing is, you see, ship I was on was struck by an iceberg, and we all had to take to the lifeboats. Middle of the night, one of the boats filled with water. All the passengers were thrown into the sea, and our boat went along to the rescue. But when we got there, they're all drowned.
Yeah.
Except this little creature lying cooing away on a lifeboat for all the world as if she were in her perambulator in Kensington Gardens. So I wrapped her up in my coat. Came the morning, we were picked up by a liner, brought back home. Nobody knew who she was, so they were going to send her to an orphanage for females, but I dug my toes in. Anything I find on my travels comes back to Cromwell Road. Anyway, I promised you a present, didn't I, Sylvia? What could be better than this?
Oh, really, Sarah, I don't know what you'll be bringing to the house next. But who do you suppose has the time to look after a baby?
I thought all women liked babies.
And that's as may be. I mean, if Miss Sylvia has any sense, she won't take it all. Which room am I to have for my nursery?
My old nursery on the top floor. It'll be lovely for it to be used again. Nana, darling, would you like to go down and bring Cook and Clara up to see this little dear?
Who's beautiful then?
Oh, Cook, isn't she gorgeous?
Oh, she might be anybody. Even royalty saved like that from the ravening waves.
Like a princess in a fairy tale.
Oh. I'd like to call her Pauline. Remember, St. Paul was rescued from the sea, so it's quite suitable.
Oh, I think she should be called after one of my pet fossils. What? Now, let's see, how about...
Babies in my nursery, sir, never have outlandish names, and they're not starting now. Miss Sylvia has chosen Pauline. That's a nice, sensible name. And called after a blessed saint. And no other name is going to be used, if you will forgive me speaking plain, sir.
Giving me a bit of trouble, so we landed and they popped me in hospital. And while I was on the mend, I made friends with this Russian, very shabby, depressed fellow. Gave the impression he hadn't always been so down at heel. More used to gorgeous uniforms, sleigh rides through the snow with all the peasants bowing and scraping. Anyway, he left Russia during the revolution. He and his wife tried to train themselves to earn a living, total failure as wage earners, of course. His wife became ill and died. Doctors didn't give Boris very long. Nurses were in a fine flap doodle about the baby. What are we going to do? The poor man's dying. So I told them, don't trouble about that. We have one baby at home that I adopted. We shall have another.
She must have a Russian name. How about Petrova?
Yes, that would suit. It sounds a bit like Peter. And if one of them's going to be called after an apostle, the other one should be. Oh. It's very nice for Pauline to have a companion. Let's hope this one has brains, as it's easy to see who's going to be Miss Blaine in my nursery. Now, sir, before you go away again, do get it into your head. This home is not a creche.
Oh.
Two babies in the nursery is right and proper, but two is enough.
Sylvia,
what is it, Clara? Something the matter?
There was a messenger called this morning with a letter for you and a pair of ballet shoes.
Ballet shoes?
And a basket.
Was all this from Gum?
Yes, miss, that's what Nana said. She took in the basket.
Oh, no, not more fossils.
No, Miss Sylvia. Another baby.
Oh, no. Well, where's it? I mean, where's Nana?
They're both up in the nursery. It's another little girl.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.